Hello everyone. Now we will see tubular processing over next few videos. In this particular video, we will see some general principles of tubular processing. First of all, from this video on, we are switching over to the schematic model of nephron for ease of understanding. Here we have cortex and medulla. This is renal corpuscle and this is renal tubule. This portion represents proximal tubule. This is loop of Henle, distal tubule, collecting duct, this is minor calyx, and these are some peritubular capillaries. So now coming to the tubular processing. We have seen that glomerular filtration produces a large quantity of filtrate. Now that filtrate is further processed during its passage through the tubule. This processing involves reabsorption of certain substances from the tubule and secretion of some into the tubule. Thus, final urine is an end product of these three processes: glomerular filtration minus tubular reabsorption plus tubular secretion. Normally 180 liter filtrate is produced every day, out of which approximately 178.5 liter is reabsorbed and about 1.5 liter is excreted as urine. As we already saw in previous video, glomerular filtration is a relatively non-selective process as essentially all the solutes in plasma are filtered except plasma proteins. Moreover, it is a passive process. On the other hand, tubular processing is a highly selective process. Here, reabsorption or secretion of individual solute is very precisely controlled to regulate its final excretion. Hence, volume and composition of urine is finalized by tubular processing. Also, it is highly energy consuming process as it involves active transport of solutes across the renal tubule. Now let's see tubular reabsorption. Reabsorption involves movement from tubular lumen into the interstitium and then from interstitium into the peritubular capillary. Movement across the epithelium can occur by two routes, transcellular and paracellular. Transcellular movement occurs through the cell. It involves passage through luminal membrane and basolateral membrane. For this, cells have different transport proteins for different solutes on their membranes. Paracellular movement occurs through apical tight junctions into the lateral interstitial space. From interstitium, majority of the solute gets drained by peritubular capillaries and some passively leak back into the lumen through paracellular spaces. Extent of this drainage by peritubular capillary is determined by Starling forces. So let me tell you about Starling forces here. We know that hydrostatic pressure in glomerular capillary is 60 mmHg. Because of efferent arteriolar resistance, hydrostatic pressure in peritubular capillaries drop to 20 mmHg. This pressure opposes fluid uptake. We also know that colloid osmotic pressure rises from 30 to 35 mmHg by end of the glomerular capillary. So colloid osmotic pressure in peritubular capillary is 35 mmHg, which promotes fluid uptake. Now interstitial pressures. The interstitial hydrostatic pressure is about 10 mmHg, which promotes fluid uptake. The interstitial osmotic pressure is 5 mmHg, which opposes fluid uptake. Thus, net driving force is about 20 mmHg in favor of reabsorption. So fluid is drained by peritubular capillary by this force. Now net driving force may change with changes occurring in glomerular fluid dynamics. So let's see how it is affected by that. We have seen in video of determinants of GFR that increased efferent arteriolar resistance increases pressure in glomerular capillary, which tends to increase GFR and reduce renal blood flow. So filtration fraction decreases. This effect has two important consequences for peritubular capillary. First, because of increased GFR on top of reduced renal blood flow, less blood flows into the peritubular capillary. So hydrostatic pressure falls below 20 mmHg. Second, with increased filtration fraction, protein gets more concentrated in plasma. So colloid osmotic pressure rises above 35 mmHg. Due to these changes, overall net driving force for reabsorption increases. So now, with higher net driving force, even more fluid from interstitium is drained and less leak back into the lumen. So net tubular reabsorption increases. In a nutshell, increased efferent arterial resistance, or in other words, constriction of efferent arteriole increases net tubular reabsorption. Such changes in tubular reabsorption are an important part of glomerulotubular balance. Glomerulotubular balance basically compensates for changes occurring in GFR. For example, here increased GFR tends to increase excretion of sodium and water. But simultaneous increase in net tubular reabsorption by these pressure changes counteracts that increase in excretion. One more thing, such effects are not seen with changes in efferent arterial resistance because it does not affect filtration fraction. So this was tubular reabsorption. Tubular secretion occurs in same way but in opposite direction. Solute first moves from capillary into the interstitium and then from interstitium into the tubule by either transcellular or paracellular route. So these are some basics for tubular processing. Up next in 11th video, I am explaining various mechanisms of transport across the cell membrane. If you are watching the series for the first time, I recommend that you watch it first. But if you are just revising, you can skip the 11th video and go directly to the 12th video where we will see transport of sodium. And yes, do not forget to like, comment, share and subscribe to keep getting more videos. Thank you.